Good afternoon. Welcome to this Exchange for Media Pitch Brand Talk. Today we have two special guests who have built a company from scratch, who continue to build it even in these tough times, and who expanded on what they've done. And in some way, they lived their motto of Hum Hai Taiyar. So when COVID hit, they were ready to go to the next level. So let me welcome Gaurav Dublish and Siddharth Sood, co-founders of this wildly popular brand called Wildcraft. Welcome, Siddharth and Gaurav. How have been the last 120 days for you?
Thanks, Anurag. They've been phenomenal. Let me use that word in both sets.
Not many people these days, when you have conversations with them, I do a daily TV show, very few people use the word phenomenal. Somebody used fantabulous other day. So I said, maybe he's on the wrong show, but I am on the wrong show. But glad that there are silver linings in this very dark cloud.
So the reason I used the word phenomenal is because, an entrepreneur's life is always a roller coaster. And when you're on that roller coaster, the higher the fall and the higher the going up, I think that's what is phenomenal. So it's been phenomenal both in terms of the kind of drops we've taken and the heights that we've taken. I think they've been very interesting times. 120 days exactly now. I remember 20th March, Gaurav and me, when the first Janta lockdown was announced, the two of us had a chat and said, this is coming. Everyone could see the writing on the wall that a larger lockdown was coming. And I think the whole idea was, as a concept, as a brand, one of our thought process or our philosophy has always been about embracing the uncertain. And I think on 20th March, there was no bigger uncertainty around us, right? And one of the things we said is, either we run away from it or we run at it. And being entrepreneurs, we decided to run at it rather than run away from it. And I think that's a call that we took on 20th of March. And we said, what is it that in this time of pandemic that we as an organization, for our team, for our company and for the country, what is it that we can solve for? What is it that we can do? And, we've been at it for the last 120 days and we'll be at it for some time to come.
And can you tell us, when do you say we've been at it? I know you launched a new campaign. You got into a new category. Tell us our viewers about it. Gaurav?
So I'll have to rewind a bit, and it's important for, Siddharth is playing that as a screensaver, actually. It is Hai Taiyar Hum. That's a campaign that was going by. We were very closely with Ogilvy and, the entire team from Mahesh Kharat to Piyush, and they assisted us in putting this that creative campaign together. For your viewers to understand what went behind this thought, it's important, Dr. Batra, for us to be able to put across the story. 22 years back, way back in 1999, actually 21 and a half years back, Siddharth and I were actually studying together. We were students of B school in Bombay, and both of us are from small cities. I'm from Meerut, Siddharth is from Shimla. He's from a capital city. I'm from a small city, actually. From a foothills of Himalayas, or literally from the hills of Himalayas, we actually never endeavored into hikes and treks and stuff. It was in 99, we were actually pursuing our management course, and one of the things which happened in management schools is that you get an internship after your first year, and under that internship, got an opportunity of working with Wipro. Wipro obviously headquartered in Bangalore, and from Bombay, they gave us a ticket to actually come to Bangalore. And the week that we landed, there was Kargil War then, 99 May. And it just so happened that all the tickets got cancelled, and we were waited. And how to be able to use, connecting with the thought of how to make an opportunity out of a problem. We met friends. We made friends with Dinesh. Dinesh is our other co-founder. He is 59 now. He was 37 then when we met him. He and his group of friends used to take to the hills around Bangalore. Bangalore is very fortunate to that extent. It has lovely, within 50 to 100 kilometers, it has lovely boulders and hikes and trails and stuff. And they used to take to the hills very often. And one thing led to the other, I started accompanying them in those 20, 25 days I was here in Bangalore. And it just so happened in the final placements, opted for any company which would give me a role in Bangalore. And so that's also the same thing happened. The two of us in July 2000, we landed up in Bangalore. Siddharth was pursuing finance, I was pursuing marketing. And we started off professional careers here. And between 99, we actually spent a lot of time to be able to scratch our heads and saying, what is it? What is it that this aspiring world of outdoors, this aspiring world of hikes and treks, lends itself to? Because it was very counterintuitive for a few of us. For example, you know, I used to run in school. I used to be in a athlete when I was in school. And for me, obstacles used to be, you know, ananithama, you know, it's something that used to irritate me. And here it was a set of 6-7 people, you know, Dinesh Adadeel, who in late 30s used to feast on obstacles. They used to take to the road less traveled, and they used to feast, which is the toughest of the routes, to be able to scale up to Savandurga or to Rangaswamy Hills or to, you know, the various hillocks around the Bangalore. And our belief was, you know, the two of us who were actually at the peripheries of people who were passionate about outdoors, was there was something which is very magnetic, which is very magnetic in the pursuit of outdoors, in the manifestation of outdoors. And to us, for us, it was our belief was that each one of us are viscerally explorers. And that
Varun, can you be a bit louder? Be louder. One of the listeners has said that you can be all louder. He says audio is not clear. I can hear you clearly well. That proves I'm not old.
I saw it. Okay, let me try. Yeah. So you know, viscerally, you're intrinsically the explorer, and at some point of time we'll discuss that, how did we come to it. But out of the belief that each one of us is an explorer, the reason for that was instinctively we believe humans are configured to not live a life which is full of comfort zone. You know, we are hardwired to live life outside a comfort zone, or to pursue a life outside a comfort zone. And while our agrarian life, while our industrious life, while a bubble that has been created is a bubble that we seek. But essentially, where we enjoy when we step out of the comfort zone, and that embracing the uncertain, the unknown, the unplanned, that's a belief. And the purpose of Wildcard
is the core value.
That's a core belief. It's a core value system. It's a core belief, actually. And on that belief is a purpose to be able to enable and equip you and me to take the road less traveled and embrace the uncertain by products and services which is configured for wilderness, sure, for the life in wilderness. So we borrowed wilderness and we borrowed crafting and we juxtaposed it and made it Wildcraft. And since 98, 99, 2000, when we were still in college, and for the last 13 years that we've been running this business together, You know, things have changed. You know, all orbits have changed. When we're looking at it, we become larger. When we're looking at it, we invest. You know, whichever way people actually tell us. But one thing which we've not left is that beauty of that purpose and the beauty of belief. And I think the hai tayar, you know, coming to the point, you know, actually we very commonly use internally. You know, when we are reviewing the team, and you know, like you have a typical jumla hota hai company mein. So we have very, very similar, you know, we say, are you ready? So people say, we are ready for anything. You know, that's typically the way we play around when we are really pitting somebody to be able to take some leaps of faith. And they're ready for anything was a thought that Ogilvy actually took it. And they said, this is a very, very beautiful thought that you are actually sitting on. You know, can we massify it? Can we use it to massify it? He said, that's something which will resonate very well internally with us. And that will also be an integrated communication. And they ground it into a hai tayar, and then hai tayar hum. And they're ready for anything which is, you take the road less taken, you embrace the uncertain, be ready for anything with the Wildcraft. That became a hai tayar, and that became hai tayar. So that's a context around which hai tayar is, to that extent. The expansion was something which came naturally for us.
And also the beauty is that, you know, I remember reading this book late 80s, early 90s, called The Road Less Traveled, M. Scott Peck, right? That's the author. You talked about it. But, you know, now you're a 1,000 crore brand, Gaurav. You build a certain scale, size, a certain expectation. What has changed after you become such a big brand in business? And what has remained the same?
See, big is always relative. You know, 1,000 crore brand is a $175 It's a $130 million brand. You know, from a global span of play, we are not even a rebel in this entire world of playing a branded one. You know, while in the world of India, we'll be very pleased with ourselves, but that's when you're looking at things. The second way of looking at things is that there are 137 crore, 38 crore Indians. There's 35 million households or 35 crore households there. And we typically end up addressing the top 10% of those households. How do we make a brand? How do we make a brand relevant? Because this embracing the uncertain, ye jo anishchita ko apnana hai, you know, this instinct is not for people who are very
involved. There is a charm in kind of romancing the unknown, so to say.
Absolutely.
There is always a charm.
And to that extent, this entire migrant instinct, this entire instinct of cerebrally, you know, artistic instinct, or physically the backpacker instinct, which is how our brands are layered, is not relevant for only the urban folks. It is as relevant to the rural India, it's as relevant to you and me, it's as relevant to the person who is somewhere got lost in his comfort zone. You know, what has happened in this pandemic is this huge pandemic has made us pause, has made us, you know, has made us stop and start reflecting, you know, what happened initially with the two of us, and possibly Siddharth will take it from there. You know, it took us 2 days to actually reflect upon where we are. You know, is it something which is really, is it surreal? Is it supposed to last? It's not going to last. And it took us some time, you know, 2 days to be able to come out of it. You know, this is not the end of the world. This is possibly one more anti-fragile hammer, which is possibly going to make us stronger if you want to choose to actually look at it from that perspective. And I think Siddharth will mention or possibly reflect upon how we were able to, in those first 48 hours, when this lockdown actually happened, were able to pull up our socks.
I want to bring in Siddharth, but I just want to ask you one more thing and get both of you to. I mean, I should have asked this question at the end, but I'll ask it right at this stage. So to set the tone, is if I talk to you in 5 years from now, and I'm not taking 10, 15, you seem like very ambitious guys. Have achieved. You may play it down saying, in a category like yours to reach 1,000 crores from scratch is commendable. And dare I say, you look like you just started. But if I talk to both of you in 5 years, where would you like Wildcraft to be?
So, you know, one of the things that we've taken, and again, you know, we want to make it relevant to 1 billion Indians. And I'll just touch upon, it's not billion Indians, it's billion Indians. You know, one of the beliefs that we have, and that belief shaped up because of our roots in a smaller city, is that for some reason, you know, you started this conversation and you're saying, Gaurav, kahan se ho, you know, where are you from? You know, one of the beauty of ways of looking at it, there's a diversity in India. And that diversity somewhere in the last 2 or 3 millennia has actually become, so I'm thinking from the perspective of bigger business. You know, one of the reflecting on it, who's 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 on it, and that piece has been somewhere to us instinctively has to be able to reach back to get our comfort zone around us. You know, Dr. Patra bole ki kya mere patra wale log ke baat karna hai, that's actually insane, right?
वो वाला डॉक्टर बतराम जो लोगों के बाल उड़ाता है वो दूसरा है वो उगाता है तो हम रेवेन्यू शेयर करते हैं बट जोक्स अपार्ट यू नो यू लॉस्ट योर वॉइस गौरव वी लॉस्ट योर वॉइस सिद्धार्थ यू कैन टेक ऑन व्हाइल वी गेट गौरव बैक सो व्हेन वी टॉक टू यू एंड गौरव इन 5 years वेयर विल वाइल्डक्राफ्ट बी व्हाट्स योर विजन व्हाट्स योर ड्रीम
व्हेन गौरव एंड वी टॉक अबाउट वाइल्डक्राफ्ट 5 years 10 years 15 years व्हाटएवर टाइम फ्रेम वी टेक we rarely talk in terms of revenue numbers, okay? Because for us, revenue is the outcome of all the inputs that we are going to do. So the focus always in the conversation that the two of us have is what are the inputs we are going to do. Now, if you are 1,000 crores, it's a nice number to have. It has a nice ring about it and all of that. And we said, you know, even 6 years, 7 years ago, we've been interviewed by someone and we said, it'll be good to get to 1,000 crores by 2020. But beyond that interview, I don't think internally we've ever driven the business by saying ki 1,000 karna hai aur 1,000 is non-compromisable. What we focused on, for example, if you take Wildcraft today, what we focused and why we were able to do what we've done in the last 120 days that we'll get to in a moment is because we focused on saying that we want to put a value chain together, right? So we've invested in people right from design to materials to research and development to manufacturing to supply chain to, you know, sales and distribution. And we've always said if you focus on the inputs correct, and if you focus on the inputs consistently, the outputs are bound to happen. They might not happen this year, they might take a year extra or 2 years extra, but what are the inputs? So from both of our perspective, I think our goal is to make, you know, 5 years ago, the answer to that question was that Wildcraft should be bigger than the two of us put together so that the two of us are dispensable in Wildcraft. I think we've achieved that over the last 5 years, that we are dispensable now in Wildcraft. You know, if a bus was to hit the two of us tomorrow morning, you know, Wildcraft will stay beyond the two of us. I think similarly, the objective of the next 5 years is how to make it relevant to, like Gaurav said, 1 billion Indias, right? And what do we need to do, whether it is in product engineering, whether it is to do with the channels, whether it is to do on how do we reach that last consumer. You know, those are the inputs that we want to focus on the last 5 years and say, how do we scale up those things? Revenue will follow. Revenue will come. I don't think revenue as an outcome is an answer to that question.
Okay, Siddharth. But let me ask this question differently. Let's not focus on the numbers for a while.
Yeah.
In terms of the impact you described on a billion Indias, because as Gaurav rightly said, you know, there is so much uniqueness and diversity every few kilometers and every few hours in India, in food, in
language,
language, in clothes, in the way we dress up. So I get that. But give me some other qualitative aspects of, for example, this category of masks. You saw an opportunity and you expanded, right? Will you be going into new product categories? Before the COVID, had you planned new launches, which for whatever reason you may not have done now? Would you like to give our viewers and readers a peek into that?
Absolutely. So, for us, you know, we are a functional and performance brand, right? We've been working with the Ministry of Defense now for nearly 4 years to create a technical rucksack for the Army Jawan. And, you know, we designed it in conjunction with the Ministry of Defense. We've won a tender to supply those rucksacks to the Indian Army. So, you know, from everything from, college campus kids to, you know, people who go to office to the Army Jawan, right? We are across categories. And for us, the functionality and the performance of the product overrides anything else that we need to put in the product, right? So with that as a thought, we've been over the last, multiple 6 months senior sessions that we have, we keep thinking about what are the new product ranges which we're going to do and all of that. Now, let me take a case of the mask and the hazmat suits, right? We are the largest branded player of rainwear products in India. You know, Wildcraft sells the maximum amount of branded raincoats and rainwear in India. Now, the hazmat is nothing but a refashioned rainwear, right? So for us, we did not have to have sleepless nights on figuring out how a hazmat suit is made. For us, it's a natural extension of what we know. We have the material engineering in-house. We know what material goes in. We know the technology. We have the manufacturing in-house. We have the competency of research and development in-house. So it took us barely 24 hours before the first hazmat suit rolled off our production line, right? Because we knew, we exactly know. So similarly on the respirators, right? Because our, we have people, we did a little bit of respirators even before COVID, you know, because people who were going hiking and trekking used to ask for this protection device. So for us, it was an opportunity where, like I said, because we had invested in the relevant research and development, material engineering and all of that, we were able to take on these opportunities and immediately go into it. Now, to your second part of your question, I think, you know, what we've done, just to give you a sense of what we've done over the last 120 days, in the first 2 months, 3 months, we scaled our manufacturing when people were laying off, were being laid off across the country. We have about 3,700 people in Wildcraft, right? And one of Gaurav's and my first port of call on 20th or 22nd March when we were discussing, the first thought process was, how are we going to save jobs? These are people we put, person by person, we built this family, person by person, and how are we going to make sure, we don't get into retrenchments or laying off people. So not only did we have 2,500 people out of these 3,700 people in manufacturing who were doing manufacturing for these respirators, we scaled up our headcount to about 30,000 people in May and June. We had, we were up to about 30,000 people who were making respirators for Wildcraft. So from 2,500 people, we went 12x on manufacturing. Similarly, on the distribution side, before COVID, we were getting distributed at about 5,000 points of sale, 5,500 points of sale, all put together, our EBOs and all of that. Today, we are distributed at about 1 lakh points of sale. Now, that's the opportunity, that we've taken. So you go to a pharmacy, you go to a grocery store, you go to a Kiriana store, you'll find us there. Someone sent me, one of my sales guys sent me a picture the other day on WhatsApp, at a Paanwala shop, you had a ladi of Paan Pasand and you had a Wildcraft mask ladi right next to it, right? So if we have to reach a billion Indias, that's the distribution network that we need to cater to. And I think we've taken a step on being able to go from the 10% of the urban households that Gaurav was talking about to going to a billion Indias. I think the distribution reach that we have created, I think that is significant. Now our next challenge is, we've created this distribution reach. Now what are we going to do with this distribution reach? How are we going to capitalize on this distribution reach? What are the products that fit into the brand that can be catered through through this distribution. So we are, there are a lot of thoughts. The teams are on it. You know, you're going to see new products, but which are going to come from the same value system that we have, the ethos that we have, the purpose that we have of helping people, you know, get equipping them for the uncertain. So it's going to come from there.
Okay, Siddharth, thank you for taking us through your thought process and how you were naturally primed up to do what you did in the last 100 odd days with your performance brand, and you know, you're working with climbers who need respiration, and you know, so it was a natural corollary for you to work on it and give back, how you saved jobs and how you expanded on your distribution. But at this point, I want to go to, you know, while a lot of us use omni-channel, I think a lot of us have become D2C, direct to consumer or digital to consumer. I want to understand how important is digital in your mix, and while digital is important, how important is television, radio, newspapers, magazines, outdoor, because you know, you're a brand about being outdoor. So I take this question to both you and Gaurav. Gaurav, first you and then Siddharth. Gaurav, I can't hear you.
We've lost your voice. Very slight. Your voice is breaking, Gaurav.
So Siddharth, while Gaurav comes back, why don't you talk to us?
Okay. You know, digital is extremely important. If you look at our audience set, you know, our audience or our target group completely sits in the digital space, right? So even before COVID, that has been a significant area of focus for us. As a matter of fact, whatever limited marketing budget we've had over the years, we've significantly spent it in digital and outdoors. As a matter of fact, those are the two mediums we've you know, before this campaign, we've not used too much of television. You know, very limited television we've done before this. But again, if you have to reach through the mass of India, I think all the channels that you spoke about, all are relevant. I don't think, you know, there are different weightages at different points in time for different products that we'll give to these channels. But I think, you know, the kind of, for example, the Hain Taiyar Hum campaign, you know, this campaign that we've done, we went out on television in a way we've never done television, right? And we believe that that was the right thing to go to the billion Indias, because while, you know, in the urban travelers or the travelers that we were targeting with Wildcraft as a brand, digital alone would have maybe sufficed. But if you have to go and sell at 100,000 points of sale, you need to use television as a media, the mass media to be used. So digital is important, television is important. Gaurav, are you back? No? I mean, we can hear you saying something, but no? Just connect the mic or something.
You know, and I love the fact that you each complete each other's sentences. You know, I can see that as a team, that you would be a real team. Because, you know, the co-founder dynamics, me being an entrepreneur, and I started, by the way, you guys started your company in 99. I started, me, Nawal and Amit started the same company in 2000. And me and Amit are MDI batchmates, and Nawal, my, you know, he was with me in the engineering school. So that's how we are friends. And we started it in 2000. And, you know, there's a good chance they know exactly what I'm thinking or something. So I see the dynamics between both of you.
So while Gaurav comes back online, you know, Gaurav and me, we've obviously known each other for nearly 22 years now, 98.
Am I audible?
Yes. Yeah, 98.
He's telling about your hostel days. Gaurav, he was telling about what all you did in your hostel.
He's going to brag about something which is not complete truth.
About hostel days, that's off the record.
Then I got to hear that, but so that you complete and then we get Gaurav.
So honestly, you know, one of the things what you're rightly saying, you know, sometimes we believe that we become redundant for each other because you can complete half the sentence of the other person. You believe ki yaar mera kya value add bacha hai because, you know, two minds are working. But one of the things that we've realized, Anurag, and on a serious note, is that, you know, one of the reasons that the co-founder dynamics work well is when the co-founders have complementary skills rather than similar skills. Okay. And I think that's where, you know, the friendship turning into business, because you hear a lot of this, you know, thing of saying friendship mein business mat karo and all of that. I think one of the great aspects there is you have to recognize what are the complementary skills. Like Gaurav's skill is to talk, mine is to listen. So you need to know what are the skills that each of you have, and you need to play to the strengths of the other's skill. I think that's a dynamic I think that the two of us have been able to figure out between the two of us, and been able to do it. As a matter of fact, between the two of us, you know, for the last 13 years that we full-time run Wildcraft, we've never had separate cabins or separate offices, right? Me and him sit about 6 feet away from each other. And, you know, on the periphery of our mind, we have, you know, what the other is talking about. We have that conversation in the periphery of our mind anyways going on. So we've never had the need to be, or we've never ever felt disconnected as co-founders from saying, are you pulling the organization in a different direction and am I taking this in a different direction? You know, we might have our arguments or fights on which direction it needs to go in. But I think once we figure that fight out, I think then we know which direction we are going in. Sorry, go back to you.
And you know, while I want to exchange for media about marketing, advertising, media, let me ask you, if both of you had to say what, as entrepreneurs, what made you successful apart from the co-founder dynamics, and if there is a playbook to being successful as an entrepreneur? Gaurav, first you, and then done.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, now you're perfect. Gaurav, you're perfect.
So, you know, one, I will not completely agree to an assertion, which is we've been successful. Yes, we've been entrepreneurial, you know, and the definition of entrepreneur being resourceful. I think we've been
louder. You have to be like a Punjabi from Delhi.
We've been reasonably resourceful, but I don't think between the two of us, we will consider ourselves to be successful. You know, success has various parameters of measurement, and last is not success in the minds of people around us, but success in the minds of us. And I think, generally speaking, I don't think we've crossed even a iota of what should be defined as successful entrepreneurs. But what has led us, I can touch upon that. You know, one of the things, you know, when we are young, we are still young actually, when Siddharth was young, was that we were very passionate. We were very passionate about, you know, making difference to people's lives, making you know, our family proud, making our nation proud, making this and that. You know, there are a lot of things that as youngsters we typically have. I think what we didn't have then, we didn't have a sense of purpose. And it was in Biocraft which uniquely somewhere, you know, the belief of we, you know, each of us being an explorer, the purpose being of rekindling the explorer in each one of us. It is to do with Dr. Batra to Mr. Sools to, you know, each one of our viewers here. How do we rekindle the explorer? How do we get them out of the comfort? And I think that gave us a very deep sense of purpose. And hence, when you speak about 5 years, it really doesn't honestly excite us. But the point is that I think what worked for us and is working for us, and possibly the day it stops working for us, I think we will start delineating these two. I think passion with purpose is something that we've learned to live with, and we have strived for it. We've survived because of it, and I think at some point in time, hopefully, we'll thrive because of it. I think passion and purpose together is what make the entire, you know, the recipe of entrepreneurship very, very interesting and exciting. And the perseverance it gets you to build upon, I think, is a critical, you know, thing. Which I think is you know, that's my point of view.
Gaurav Dublish says 3 P's of entrepreneurship: passion, purpose, and persistence.
So this is what happens, Anurag. Perseverance was my point, but Gaurav took it away. Chalo. This is what exactly you were saying.
Gaurav, what was the story that Siddharth was going to tell about the hostel, and you said it's not true? So, Siddharth, are you going to tell the story, or I'm going to get Gaurav to tell his story?
Tell whatever is in his mind, because if I start rattling out stories, that might go on for a long time.
Yeah, but I'd love to hear that one story that he was expecting you to say.
No, Gaurav, I'm sure Gaurav just wants to tell your audience that how you know, like a mother, I've cared for him in the hostel when he came down with jaundice, and how our friendship really evolved in him being down with jaundice and me peeling papayas for him, which I've never done in my life.
Good. So if I would say you are a husband, wife who given birth to a child called Wildcraft, right? Tell us, what are the roles each one of you play?
I'll go first.
Yeah, yes,
I'll go first. Now. You know, whether being a husband or wife, I am a victim of domestic abuse. Okay, so my role is to be able to take domestic abuse in this relationship. So that's what it is.
I think the way we see it is, I think it's about balance. I don't think we've ever sat down, the two of us, and we've ever carved out saying, tu ye karega aur main ye karunga. There are certain domains that we come from. You know, I come from a finance domain, he comes from sales and marketing. But it's not like he's not taking finance calls on my behalf, or I've not taken sales and marketing, or I've not got into that, or he's not got into that. I think what's worked well is that the two of us, whenever we have a divergence of thought, is when I think we go for a drink or a coffee or whatever time of the day is, depending on the time of the day, and thrash it out, and then be able to present that singular unified view to the team. And it's not like the team has not seen us arguing. You know, our team sometimes get really worried when they see us arguing in our glass door cabin, saying ye dono ek dusre ka sar phod denge. But the point is, I think what really works is to speak your heart out. You know, one of my favorite books of all time is Pour Your Heart, which is Howard Schultz, right? It's exactly like that. You know, the you don't hold back, because you know the problems come when you start holding yourself back, when you start double guessing. You know, when you're thinking ki yaar iska kya agenda hai, kya objective hai, you know, just speak out, talk there, and get it clarified. I think that's what's really worked in this dynamics.
So let me stay with some different. You know, you mentioned Dr. Bhatta, you mentioned husband wife. You know, I do not know how to react to it, but you know, the other day I was watching this old movie When Harry Met Sally.
It's about husband and wife. Tom Hanks.
Yeah, exactly. And Meghan. So you know, and it has this juxtapositions of every half an hour there's this old couple which comes in and gave their own story. You know, one of the beautiful thing in that, and I still remember it connected with me, is you know, one of the husbands actually said, and wife, and just paraphrasing what I understood from it, you know, organizations are essentially to us organisms. They're like organisms. Right? And in an organism, what happens is, and it helps somewhere to be able to look at the power of two, or the power of one is, you know, for the two of us, and I think we broadly agree to it. In that organism, I believe Siddharth is the brain, I'm the heart. And Siddharth knows, you know, the brain knows that without a heart, brain doesn't matter. And the heart knows that without a brain, it doesn't exist. So I think that's the way we actually build this piece. You know, when it comes to cerebrally interpreting things which is in front of us, which is logic and rational and everything else, that's where his skill sets actually, our computers start getting executed. It doesn't mean that he doesn't have a heart. And similarly, when it comes to taking leaps of faith, you know, pushing the envelope and everything else, which is not reflecting on what has happened in the past, but more taking intuitive calls in the future. I think he lets me have my way. Ultimately, he has his way, and that's a different issue, but he makes me feel that I have my way. And that's the way we've managed it. And
I'm not going to say that you have a brain. I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to endorse that.
I jokingly say, people say, they talk about brain. I said, God made four kinds of people. People like Siddharth Sood, who have both hair and brains. People who have some have hair, some have brains. And people like me, no hair, no brains. I don't have a brain. When I was born in, I was like, God was born in UP. I was born in a part of the country where they don't use their brain. It just doesn't come into play, even if they have one, which is Haryana. I was born in Haryana. Yeah, so, you know, it just doesn't work out like that.
Sir, live streaming is a lot
more. But it's good fun talking to you. And, you know, I hope we can get together sometime and over whatever time. By the way, I keep saying at some point, there is an evening in some part of the world. So you can always open a bubbly, you know. You don't have to wait for the sun to go down in India. You can open an iPad and, you know, you can open a country that works for you. So coming back to marketing. Now, you talk about how digital has become important. And Gaurav, you were talking about the kind of TG you have, you know, who step out of their comfort zone. They're looking for experiences which are outdoor and they need a companion. Wildcraft is that companion, so to say. So tell us, how is digital? You took this TV campaign because viewers are glued, because they're inside their homes, they're glued to television. Television viewership is an all-time high. Also, the rates are more palatable, so on and so forth. But tell us, what was the output of this campaign?
You know, just to be able to, and you asked this question earlier also, when which is the rituals, which is the various, various modes of reaching out to people, you know, digital and physical and anything else. See, for the two of us, you know, surprisingly, we've never, and this question comes to us and the two of us are not able to palate it. We've not looked at digital or non-digital as two distinct animals themselves. For us, it's a bridge. You know, a channel, a mode is a bridge. I have a consumer who's sitting, who has his needs, which are physical needs, functional needs, and he has needs which are emotional needs. You know, I need to be able to use all bridges available to be able to connect to that physical and emotional need set. Okay, now what digital does very, very nicely is it works on the power of one. You know, at a micro level, I can actually track it, and that for the data scientists in us gives us a lot of hope and conviction that this is the right piece. But what also happens is that it has its limitations. You know, it's still an evolving, evolutionary bridge. You know, the standard bridge is a traditional media, which is the bridge which is there, which all said and done, Indians still consume significantly. So if you have to get a reach, if you have to create a reach and an impact, you need mass media options, the traditional media option. The television is possibly the best. If you have to connect emotionally, we believe the best media, I believe the best media is, you know, television, which is slightly larger in life and be able to connect emotionally. When it comes to functionally, when it comes to frequency, when it comes, you know, since you asked a marketing question, I think digital is a brilliant media because I can see how many times I've hit Dr. Batra, you know, repeatedly, which I'm not able to understand from mass media because there I'll get an instant report at some point of time. So I think we have, even in this campaign, you know, just to be able to give you a sense from a money apportionment, 45%, 40-45% was on digital. You know, people may not have realized it, but we YouTube, we actually selected some 11 platforms and we said we'll only go after those 11 platforms to be able to create a bridge. And both the sides were looking at reach. Heavily digital was also looking at frequency, whereas the mass media was creating the appeal at the emotional level. So when we took out the clarion call of Hai Taiyar Hum, which is verifying anything thought, we said that we heavily use a functional kijaga emotional platform, and we took the music as a singular stream. And if you see, we've actually gone live with Jio Saavn. You know, Jio Saavn has listed us, Gaana has listed us, Wink has listed us. We are then YouTube. And obviously we were playing, we played some 25,000 spots in television channels across genre. And I don't know whether you're aware of it and your viewers are aware of it. We are the first brand who actually came with a Hindi Punjabi mix song, which was Hai Taiyar Hum, which was sung by Duran Sisters. And
I should have listened to it before it, but I'm going to say honestly, I haven't, but I'm curious. And I promise you, I will listen to it after this.
Please do. And give us...
I'll get my kids to listen to it, my wife. I have, by the way, Exchange for Media is a business of music site called loudest.in. And we every year do a huge conference on the business of music called Music Inc. We've done the third version. We did virtually because, you know, we didn't want on the World Music Day, where music meets business, where music meets brand, where music meets technology, where music meets money. We are about the business of things. So, in fact, next one we will definitely.
I'm going to
listen to it.
And one of the things that possibly you can create a hook is how we are able to connect with that beautiful melody that you created around Hai Taiyar Hum. And we actually took it in 7 different genres apart from Hindi Punjabi, which was in Bengali, Marathi, the 4 South Indian languages. And we employed the services of the talent, which was local. So if you go to Malayalam, it was Thaikudam Bridge. You know, in Punjabi, it was Nuran Sisters who actually played the song for us. It's a very spirited song, which beautifully reflects the spirit of Hai Taiyar Hum, is ready for anything. And I think that was the medium. So the medium honestly doesn't matter. To us, there is obviously science to digital, there is science to non-digital. And I think with the partners at Ogilvy and Mindshare, I think they did a phenomenally good job. And I think the credit goes to the way our partner, which is Good Morning Films, was able to, despite the odds, Dr. Batra, just for your viewers, you know, we actually shot it during the peak of the pandemic. You know, we actually started shooting this video from the first week of May, between 5th of May to 15th of May. And it was shot in 3 cities. It was shot in Guwahati, in Goa, and in Delhi. And, you know, the director there has to navigate people who are not able to step out. He was actually stuck in Bombay himself. You know, getting music arranged with Neuron Sisters, composing with Abhishek Arora, getting it lyricized by Shailendra Singh, composing it, you know, and the two of us are reasonably tough taskmasters, so we didn't want to agree to even a single point being up and down. And he navigated all of us and he was able to build this beautiful symphony, which we are so, so fond of. And not only that, he also assisted us, hopefully assisted us in getting it customized to 7 different languages with their own lyrics and their own beat, which is resonating the same melody, but a different beat. And I think to get back to your question, digital, mass media, they are just bridges. You know, we will choose to deploy them. The aim is Dr. Batra's emotional mindset. If it's digital today, it will be non-digital tomorrow, and we need to be able to ensure that we are reaching.
I'm a screenager too. I may not be a teenager, but my kids are, but I'm a screenager. So, you know.
So how can you say that? You know, age is just a mindset. You know, it needs to be, you know, are you ready for anything? If as long as you're ready for anything, you're a teenager for life.
I can kid myself. I call myself a hairless, toothless infant. That's after I've had a couple of drinks, you know, not before that. But, I'm referring to coffee before, you know. I only drink. A lot of people call me and they say, oh, I'm not very fond of drinking.
Actually have a title called Coffee with a Jar.
No, actually, I'm not a jar, but it's okay. I have lots of jar friends. You know, I have to tell you, I was talking to my 12-year-old son last year. And I said, Prasan, his name is Prasan. I said, Prasan, you're Punjabi. He said, no, Papa. I am from South Delhi. So, jaat to bahut dur hai. They're very South Delhi kids, you know. I did grow up in old Gurgaon where all my classmates were Kadyans and Kataryas and, you know, lots of jaat. And I went to engineering school where there are lots of jaat, but that's okay. They were fun and they're some of my closest friends. By the way, Gaurav and Siddharth, I know how tough your domain is, but some of my engineering friends, you know, they were either seniors to me or my batchmate, went on to start, apparel brands and some work for large apparel companies. Because me and Naval went to a textile college before we went to our respective business school. I went to MDI, Naval went to IMI. And Amit was my MDI batchmate. But, I know Rahul Singh of Beer Cafe used to work for Reebok, right? I don't know if you know that. Subinder Singh Prem used to be at Reebok. He's from IMT, he's not from my business school, but he's a friend. And then another friend of mine, who's joined somebody who was an OEM manufacturer. It's called Alsys.
Now it's become a brand. Yeah.
But basically, they've gone back to doing OEM because building a brand takes a lot of, it takes a lot of leap of
faith. You have to embrace the uncertain.
Yes. So his name is Ravish Nanda. He's the junior partner in that. So I understand how tough it is. For example, Shubhinder has a brand, but he's primarily, what I understand from my friends, it's primarily an OEM manufacturer. So, you know, to build a brand takes a lot. That's the point I'm trying to. Yeah. Now, I want to ask you two questions before I bring in two audience questions. One is, which are the other brands in various categories that you look up to? Siddharth, first to you and then to Gaurav, and why? And if there is a brand in your category that you look up to, no problem, you can mention
that. That category is a brand that, it's an international brand. It's a brand called Artrix. It's an outdoor brand based out of the Americas. And that's a brand that, you know, just for the quality of the product and the design thought that goes in and, you know, the finesse that every, trim that they use and the thought process that goes behind it. I think that's like a top of the mind recall that I have.
How do you spell that brand?
Artrix. Artrix.
Artrix. Yeah. And so have you been inspired by that brand?
No, if you ask me when we, 7 years ago, I didn't even know the brand, but as you get exposed to more and more outdoor brands, you know, you go to international shows, exhibitions and see, and then you start picking up, you know, what are the brands which are doing path-breaking stuff in the outdoors. I think that's a brand that resonated in terms of how they were approaching the product, philosophy. We are heavily a product-led company, right? We invested in product, one of the anecdotes we have is our first couple of hires were actually design people when Gaurav and me came and started Wildcraft 13 years ago full-time commercially. Our first set of hires were actually in design and product, not in sales. We said sales to kar lenge, but hame design of product is what we have to make sure that the foundation of that is right. And I think the product really excites us, the product. So when we see a nice product coming out from a company, both of us gravitate towards product. Companies that have come out with really good products.
And Gaurav, which are the brands that you look up to and why?
So I don't know as a brand, but I look as a business. I think Uniqlo has done a phenomenally good job.
Okay, yeah.
It's a Japanese fast fashion. Yes.
When the store opened, I remember my daughter was a young adult, was like so excited as if, her father or mother were doing something. They owned the company or something. But she was very excited. I mean, she's a millionaire.
It is, and they've been typical of Japanese way of doing things. You know, it doesn't even call out a brand. You know, if you wear a shirt of them, you do not even know that's Uniqlo. And, the way they've been passionate about material engineering, I think they've used material engineering as their core foundation, and they've actually delivered through material engineering, making products which are there, mass accessible to people. I think that business model has been it's not fast fashion at all. It's not like a Zara or H&M. It's actually the counter of that. For example, if you look at the shirt, for example, I wear the formal shirt, what I picked up in 2014, the same shirt is still available in 2019. I just keep on picking up the same thing. So I think that's one business model that I've always looked up to.
And Gaurav, who are the people that you've looked up to beyond Siddharth? I know you look up to Siddharth and Siddharth looks up to you in very unique ways, but on a very serious way, who are the people that you learned from, that people you come in contact and, you thought you learned from something from them and kind of implemented that consciously or subconsciously in what you do?
Okay, this is the first time. So I looked up to my dad, my father. He's been a man of letters and he's from publishing background and he's a poet.
Publishing background.
Yeah, we made it is a big publishing hub. So hence where you said Amar Ujala and Danny Jagan and everything else. So he knows them personally, most of them. But he's also a poet. And the way he navigates the language Hindi is something I've always looked up to. And he's one I look up to. And I think that should answer the question. Sid?
And Siddharth, apart from Gaurav, who well do you look up to?
Yeah, mine's very clear. Whenever I credit my entrepreneurial streak, I give it to my grandfather. And, this is a story I've told Gaurav also multiple times. When I was a kid at the dining table, he used to run a pharmacy shop in Shimla. I'm from Himachal, Shimla, right? And, he used to spend time with his grandchildren, but he used to be on the phone in those days, I'm talking early 80s, with his sons, which is my dad and all, asking ki aaj ka score kya hai? What is the sale that you've done today? That used to be the score. And I think, that those dinner table conversations with him, he passed away when I was 10, 12 years old. But I think, that DNA or that behavioral aspect of entrepreneurship, I always credit him for kind of putting it into me when I was, still learning how to eat with a spoon. So.
Fantastic. And if you had to say one good thing about Gaurav, what would it be?
One thing about Gaurav?
And on a serious note, we can keep doing the banter and it is fun, but on a serious note, what is something that you admire about Gaurav but you never told that to Gaurav?
We don't hold back. If I like something about him or don't like about him, we'll know most of it.
So what is that one thing that makes Gaurav so unique? You said he's the talking type, you're the listening type, but beyond that?
No, I think he's the risks that he's willing to take. Some of those risks, which I might at a point in time, my cerebral me would tell me that these are not risks worth taking. But I think the risks, all of us like to say we have the 30,000 feet vision, but sometimes he has that spark of a 300,000 feet vision, which I really like about him, saying, okay, I've, really up there in the Brahmand and I can see this is going to happen. So that knack sometimes, I like that knack, and I think behind that knack, then we can do all the mathematics of how much risk to take or not to take.
Okay, conviction and risk taking.
Yeah.
What is it, something about Siddharth that you like? I mentioned,
and I think he just corroborated that. When I say behind the heart,
he likes my books. All that the books that you see behind him, all are stolen from me. So that he for sure likes. That I can tell you.
Yeah.
So,
what one quality in Siddharth that you like?
As I mentioned that, between the two of us, we've always complemented each other with the brain and heart. And one of the attributes of our brain is to be able to put a rational thought process very, very quickly. The heart can actually mislead you a lot. And what I've always relied on him is if somewhere it's not sound, it's going to get, taken apart. And if at any point of time I'm able to convince him, that's it, then I'm done. So, that I think he takes time to get convinced, but the fact that he gets convinced convinces me even more. So I think I really like that he's thorough. He's not somebody who just says, "Chalo, karke dekhte hain." He's thorough. He'll not let us sit in and sleep in peace if it's not thorough.
Fantastic. Now, since Siddharth, you talked about books, I'm a big book alcoholic. Normally people steal my books. I buy 50, 60 books in a week. Not these days, but normally, and I do read one or two of them. but I kind of feel that if I quote them, it will they'll get into my head and I'll be wise. But I'm working on it for many years. Someday I'll be wise. Maybe when I grow up, like I want to be like both of you and be wise. But that's some part. But what if you could recommend one book or two books, Siddharth, that you read recently or in your journey have helped you, what would those be?
Okay, so let me tell you, recently, What You Do Is Who You Are, Ben Horowitz, venture capital guy, A16Z.
Read all his books. I read his book, The Hard Things of Hard Things.
Hard Things about Hard Things.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
I was looking for it because all
I have a book alcoholic. You can do a book quiz with me.
If you see the post-it notes, they are my handwritten post-it notes in that book. So that's one that I read recently.
I've not read this one though.
Yeah.
I like it.
I read something by a guy called Kai-Fu Lee recently, which is on AI superpower. It's on artificial intelligence, and very plainly put, very easy to understand on artificial intelligence and how China is taking the lead on that. It's a guy called Kai-Fu Lee. So these are the two, at the top of my mind that I like. On the light reading side, the couple of ones that I recently read were mostly scam related books. One was, the $1 billion Whale, the 1MDB scandal.
Can I tell you? I met the main director on it. About 3 months back.
And the other one I read was on the Theranos story, Bad Blood.
In fact, she used to be, when I bought business, when I would talk of innovation, I would put her out of Bloomberg Business Week, Fortune Forbes. And I said, we've not built a product company. Look at her. If the media was going rara about her. And she turned out to be a big hoax.
One of my all-time favorites, obviously, is Pour Your Heart Into It by Howard Charles. I really like it because it's come really from the heart. This was his first book, and he really wrote it from the heart on how he was able to build a business together. So those are some of mine.
And Gaurav, yours?
Yeah, one all-time favorite, which is a book on. It's a kind of philosophy of our life. It's Bach's. Jonathan Livingston Seagull. I've read it for 8-9 times.
I gifted it to my son and he is crying, saying, Papa, I don't read books. And I gifted it to him. He said, my daughter, on the contrary, makes up for that. But I love that book. I read it. Sometimes I go back and read it, that book now.
Exactly. It's very, very meditative. That's my all-time favorite. And the second...
It's a very short book, though.
That's the beauty of the book. It's And I think the second one, there's so many second, but it's by Nicholas Talon. It's a book named Anti-Fragility. I remember reading it some 3 years back. I remember when I got it, I was, Siddharth was eyeing that book and I was just going through it gleefully. And when this pandemic situation happened, first thing which came to me was that beautiful principle of anti-fragility and how you can actually, if you're able to configure yourself to be able to configure for the anti-fragility, how you can do this. But I think it's a brilliant book for people who are struggling to navigate the ambiguity and uncertainty of the pandemic to be able to actually. So I think these two books is what comes to my mind.
Okay. If you had to give one advice to everyone watching this, especially which is relevant in the last 120 days, what would it be? Siddharth, first you and then Gaurav.
I think having faith in yourself and perseverance. I think losing hope is not an option. There are always opportunities. You have to open your eyes. You have to be persevered and look for those opportunities. You will find those opportunities.
Okay, Gaurav, yours.
I think I touched upon the only advice that I'll have is to get sharpen the purpose of your life. Get a very, very strong purpose which resonates with your belief systems and be passionate in life. And if you can combine the two, I think that's when...
Good. It's been a pleasure talking to you. There are two questions and there is one comment. I'll take the question. SM Minakshi is asking, good afternoon. How has the media usage changed pre-COVID and post-COVID? And what do you think are the media spends versus revenue and consumer customer behavior?
What is the first one again?
See, how have basically the consumer behavior changed? Both the questions on media spends versus consumer behavior.
See, we used to spend on media, now we spend on media. So that's the, but go ahead.
But Arthur, see, the consumer behavior changed, I think, obviously, as was expected. See, what is behavior hinged on? Behavior is what, hinges on the attitudes, and attitudes are hinging on beliefs. And that's a typical psychology, the way it works. So, what has happened here is the belief system has got a bit shaken up that, something like this. See, what has happened, Dr. Batra, is over the last 4 decades, literally, I think after and possibly before the two of us born, which is the emergency. Post-emergency, something like this has not happened. So in our generation, something like this has not happened. So the belief that we have constructed is that we are in a bubble. And in the bubble, we are, somebody will take care of these things. We are connected and there is enough and more science which is behind it in history and philosophy. What has happened is this pandemic has shaken a lot of these beliefs. So people are still recouping to this shaken belief system, and that's reflecting in behavior patterns becoming very, very uneven, unpredictable. And so that's one, that's our interpretation to what the, today you'll be smiling and yet tomorrow you'll be extremely frustrated and you'll come out of it within the same day. So it's become, the longer it stretches, the longer people will become, is what our take is. That's a consumer behavior, and a behavior of consumer is this. Today, you will be actually hoarding stuff because somewhere in your mind, this stuff is not going to be available. And the next 2 months, you'll not be consuming anything. So it's very difficult to predict. So speak. So that's one thing, our interpretation of consumer behavior.
Never say never. One thing you're saying is, one, you clearly said sharpen your purpose. And that links up with even in the media, you said, what do you want to achieve with it? I'm sure always there is an ROI question, but it is also long-term brand building. Now, while your turnover is 1,000 crores, possibly your brands are bigger than that, You have to value your brands.
Absolutely, it's true. But I think on the second question or first question, which is to do with the media, this time we very clearly articulated our objectives to be reach-led. And it was hinged around emotionality, emotional connect between the brand purpose and your need set and your mindset. So I think that was the intent. And the campaign is just winding down, as so to speak. Obviously, the Clarion call will never wind down, but the campaign will wind down as we speak in the month of July. And the specific metrics of it will come to light, whether we've been able to. We know for sure that it's taken the brand equity to a different orbit altogether. What orbit kya hai, wo obviously, I'm sure
it does impact that. Ashish Anand is asking, I have a question. Having an idea is one thing, executing is another. How did you go about executing your ideas and giving them shape?
Absolutely. I mean, execution is key. I mean, that's bang on, right? Ideas, like they say, are a dime a dozen. How you execute. And I think the if you take our last 12, 13 year journey, or even the last 120 days, either one you take, right? One common thread you'll get into is, how do you convince a larger team, the teams that we have, on believing in what you are telling them, and then harnessing that power of people to get into execution, right? Some of our best guys, got the team that Gaurav and me have built, are people, whom we hired at very young ages. And the reason we hired them at young ages is not because we are, is because they're malleable, right? They don't come with preconceived notions. So we traded youth for, in a lot of places, for domain expertise. We said, ideally I would have had domain expertise, but if I have to have a trade-off, we've traded youth. We've taken youth at the cost of domain expertise. And we've said supply chain na seekh jayega. Kya hai? Supply chain mein baithega to seekh jayega, right? And I think that has brought in a very different mindset on execution, because they've not been shackled by the way they've been used to doing certain things.
So,
right?
So they can do what is classically called blue sky thinking.
Exactly.
There's no constraints. Absolutely.
Absolutely. They're no holy cows, right? They're the aise hi hota hai wala mindset nahi hai. So execution, when they get into execution, they start from a very basic question, like the two of us will always start saying, agar hum ek respirator bana rahe hain, भैया बनता कैसे है? Let's get into understanding. Let's not say हम, we'll sell 5 crore respirators. Let's understand how is it made, and when people are willing to roll up the sleeves, if you'll see in our office, when our office used to work, you know, you'll come, you'll see people with rolled sleeves. You know, even on this call, I have a rolled sleeve, because that's the philosophy of the company, that you have to, you know, we expect our leaders to be completely clued in on what is happening on the ground. If a head of manufacturing, he's come from a non-manufacturing background, but if the tailor tells him that boss, ye needle aise nahi chal raha hai, he should be able to sit on that machine and tell him ki ye chal sakta hai. Until, and that is how you get the, you know, that is how leaders are made. That is how you get people to follow you, because you know that, you know, there is that passion there. You've rolled up the sleeves. You know what needs to be done to get it done. And I think that's a very, very core skill set that we have at Wildcard, that, you know, execution pehle, phir baad mein baat, English baad mein karenge.
Thank you so much, Siddharth. Thank you so much, Gaurav. It's been a pleasure talking to you. I'm really looking forward to seeing you sometime and having you guys buy me coffee. And you're in Bangalore, right?
Yes.
So Bangalore is a lovely city. So I hope sometime soon I can come to Bangalore and see you guys. Or if you're in Delhi, we'll get to see you. And
thank you.
Wish you luck in your endeavor to pursue your passion, to be purposeful, and to be staying persistent in whatever you want to achieve. I hope you build a global brand from India. And I can see the ambition and the fact that you're very, you know, grounded. I'm sure you'll be able to build a very big impact in whatever you do, and numbers are, you know, subsequent out, you know, byproducts. So I wish you luck. I've enjoyed this conversation on a Monday afternoon. It's been a magnificent Monday, if I can say that. And I wish you luck. Look forward to chatting with you guys again.
Bye. Thank you so much. Bye, Gaurav. Thank you so much.
And I, you know, I'll join Gaurav. The only thing I steal from anywhere is books. That's the only thing I feel. I have, you know, Gaurav, you and me will do. I'll give you a lot more books. Take care.
Thank you, sir.
Good to speak to you guys. Bye. Cheers.